Yeah, this is a mess. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 221, on the road again. Apologies to Willie Nelson. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Wearing the bicycle helmet because, I was looking at Katie Allen's Facebook page. Popped up in my timeline. Hello, there we go. And this is what was going on out in Wyoming today. So, yeah, wasn't looking too great. So, Katie, I was out riding my bike today. It was 70 degrees here in North Carolina. It's going to be 50 tomorrow. So, we won't have any snow probably until January or February. But we'll be thinking about you. I know Christian says he doesn't listen to any other podcasts, but you probably watch this one. Give a little wink and a to Ham Radio Now on the next 100 watts and a wire, okay? Let's see. We're going to get on the road on the way back from Chicago with a little side trip over to Rock Island, Illinois. I'll tell you about that in just a moment. First, I guess let me do the Arvin thing. HamRadioNow.tv. If you're interested in these programs, if you like them and you get something out of them and you haven't already done it, stop by HamRadioNow.tv. And you can kick in some cash or you can join the Patreon and become part of a monthly contribution. So that's the deal there. The reason I'm keeping this on is on these on-the-road programs, I've always had a little bit of trouble getting good sound. And you know I like good audio on Ham Radio Now. Like good audio. I've used a lavalier microphone, like this one. Can I get to the micro cam? That's not the micro cam. That's not the micro. There it is. Yeah, a little lavalier microphone like this one. Hold it there and you can see it pretty well. Usually, just tie it, here to my shirt someplace. But in the moving car, that's pretty noisy. And it's actually been hard to hear me, hard to hear what I was saying. So I wanted to try something different. And so I was wearing a baseball cap, and I don't have the baseball cap, so I'm keeping this on here. And this is what I did. This is what I do for you people, trying to make things better. I clipped the lavalier to the visor of the hat so that it sat closer to my mouth. I plugged it in. I didn't test it. It was not switched on. There's the lavalier. And as you can hear, we've talked about this before. There's a little bit more background noise because it's an omnidirectional microphone, not Bob Heil, because it's a condenser mic. It is a condenser mic, but that's not why there's the extra background noise. It's just because the PR40 here is a very directional microphone, and all the noise is back there from a couple of computers running. So you pretty much don't hear them on the PR40. So same thing in the car. There was still a lot of background noise, but not nearly as much as when I had the lavalier clipped down here. And we were hearing everything. Okay, so more about this, but now I can get rid of the paraphernalia. This is a good ride. Okay, back to normal. In addition to having that lavalier clipped to my head, it was plugged into the camera, which was sitting on a tripod on the passenger seat. And now I can pull that out and you can see, this is the connector, the professional XLR connector. Where are we here? And it was just plugged into the side of the camera, but it was not plugged in very well. And so as I headed out in the morning, everything was fine. And then unbeknownst to me, because I wasn't monitoring the audio from the camera, at some point it would fail. So you'll hear that coming up. But there was still some good stuff that I recorded. And I had a second mic. The second mic was down by the speakers to pick up the stuff coming from the radio. It could hear my voice just a little bit. And you know, I made some interesting contacts and occasionally some interesting comments. So the mic that was down by the speaker was a long way from my mouth. So if you thought that the lavalier sitting here was going to be noisy, the mic sitting down by the speaker would be really noisy. But you'll hear it. You'll hear what that's all about in just a minute. So what I'm going to do is I'll just pop in here from the studio every now and then and fill in some gaps a little bit. I'm going to talk about a lot of stuff, different topics and ham radio things, and I'm going to work some DX. Maybe this time, since this is going to be a long program, it's going to run about 2 hours, and there's a lot of different things. Maybe on the YouTube show notes thing, the YouTube notes thing that is on YouTube just below the video, I can put in time codes that would lead you to specific things within the program. And so maybe I'll do that sort of like per subject. Okay, so now this program starts, my trip starts in the middle of the night. Again, I left Chicago on Monday morning. The Tapper Conference was Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I spent Monday afternoon riding around. No, I take it back. I spent Sunday afternoon editing the Flex thing that they paid me to stick around and edit. So I spent Monday morning driving around some of the old haunts, my old neighborhoods and stuff. And then I headed out to Rock Island, Illinois, which is out on the Mississippi River. It's a couple of hours west of Chicago. And Monday evening, I visited my brother, Jay. No ham radio call sign. Jay, what's the problem here? Jay's been in radio all of his life. He shares my love of radio and broadcasting and to some extent technology. He's not an engineer either. I'll explain that in just a moment. Slow down, Gare. Take it easy. We're doing okay. Here's why the program starts in the middle of the night. Jay is the CEO and general manager of WVIK FM radio, which is the public radio station for the Quad Cities, Rock Island, Moline, Davenport, and something else there. On the Mississippi, half of it in Illinois, half of it in Iowa. So he's the big mucky muck about the radio station. He's been working his way up to these high power positions for some time. It's at Augustana College. Even though he's the CEO and general manager, I think he still really loves the getting on the air part. That's never left him. You know, he is the manager. He runs the show, but he still loves being on the air. So he gets up in the middle of the night, like 3 o'clock in the morning, and he hosts the local version of Morning Edition, the morning show on National Public Radio. If you've never tuned into that. And he gets on there and in between the national stuff coming down the network pipe, he introduces and talks about the stuff that is coming and going on the program, the local stuff. So he gets up in the middle of the night to do that. That goes on the air at like 5 o'clock in the morning and gets done at 9, I think. I think he does it because it's the only time of day that he can actually really get some work done without people bothering him all the time. Oh, by the way, if you're a ham out there in the Quad Cities and you're looking for some tower space for repeaters, before you ask, they don't own the tower. They lease their space. So he won't be able to help you. Sorry. Okay. Tell you what, let's get on the road. Let's get rolling after. And so that's why this is starting out in the pitch black middle of the night. So let's find out what time it is. Let's do a time check. that kind of got buried in the noise, but it translates to 5 o'clock in the morning. Let's see, my brother's on the radio here.
By the tragedy, after an extensive investigation, today's report will divulge what brought
the I don't know if he's on the air yet or not. We'll find out in a minute. I'm in Rock Island. Oh, this is Ham. Somebody wants to pull in here. Jeez. I'm in Rock Island, Illinois. There was a 7-Eleven over there. It is 5 o'clock in the morning. The sun hasn't come up yet. I'm on the way back from the digital. I have no idea where I'm going here. Rock Island, Illinois, on the way back home from the Digital Communications Conference. That was in Chicago. And this is not exactly the direct way back. But my brother lives over here. And I haven't seen him since a few years ago when I drove out to Seattle. So it was a couple-hour drive, three-hour drive west of Chicago. Came over and spent the night. And he's back. Did I start the show yet? Ham Radio Now, episode fill in the blank, because I don't know when this is going to get done. I'm going to stop somewhere in southeastern Ohio, maybe Dayton, but I'm going to try to get a little bit past Dayton. If I get in early enough, maybe I will get this edited. Bob Alphen is sitting at home saying, I wish Gary were working on the Navassa de-expedition video. And I will be, Bob, as soon as I get back. So many videos, so little time. Now, did I say I'm Gary Pierce, KM4AQ? All the stuff out of the way. I'm hoping that my audio is a little better for this mobile thing. And by the way, thanks to you guys who have been encouraging me to make these on-the-road videos. They seem to be fairly popular. I mean, they don't drive the YouTube numbers through the roof, but I get more than a handful of individual emails or comments on YouTube or whatever when I make a note that I'm going to be heading to a ham fest or to the conference or whatever, saying, are you going to make another video? On the road, so like that. Especially some of you folks from outside the U.S., other place in the world. You see, you like to watch the U.S. countryside go by as I'm talking about technology that might or might not have anything to do with right where I am. Anyway, I'm hanging one of my lavalier microphones from my hat. Trying to have it pretty close to my mouth. Improve the signal-to-noise ratio from the noise in the car. The good old Q-mobile, Toyota RAV4. 2007 model, currently at 145,666 miles. So, been a good car. And I am working my way through Rock Island. I would sing the Rock Island Railroad song. Rock Island Line. The Rock Island Line is a mighty good line. The Rock Island Line is a road to ride. But I don't sing very well. So, but unfortunately, this microphone flops around a little bit. So when I turn my head quickly, it will sometimes get real close to my mouth and sometimes get a little farther away. It's an experiment.
Additional warning, gale warning, 1 8-hour forecast, new low, inland, 59 north, 64 west, over forecast waters between 180 and 420 nautical miles each quadrant.
Okay, that's 5 megahertz WWV. And well, with the antenna at the 5 megahertz position, 10 megahertz wouldn't be too good, but I'd hear it, and there's nothing, so the higher frequencies are empty. But even though 5 megahertz is doing pretty good,
There's nobody on 60 meters. There might be somebody listening. You know what they say? The band can be open, people can be out there, but if nobody calls CQ, then nobody knows. Is there anybody using this frequency? Is this frequency in use, KN4AQ? Hello, CQ, CQ, CQ. Calling CQ 60 meters on channel 4. Hello, CQ, CQ, CQ. CQ 60, calling CQ. This is KN4AQ. Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec. KN4AQ Mobile. Rock Island, Illinois. Calling CQ 60 and listening. Anybody out there on channel 4? Take that as a no. But there are five or four other channels. So I am going to stay off the interstate for a while and take Illinois 150. I like a U.S. highway is not what you'd call a back road, but anymore, you know, nobody drives them from one place to another if there's an interstate nearby. And I will be paralleling an interstate, but if I've got a few extra minutes to spend on a over-the-road trip and I can get off the interstates, I will do it. There's a 220 repeater listed in the directory on 224.1. KN4AQ Mobile, but nothing keys up. And that is the way with repeater directories. Full of a lot of repeaters listed that aren't on the air or have some other parameter changed, tone, whatever, which means you aren't going to talk on them. I talked to the guy who created and maintains the R-Finder application at Dayton, and I talked to the guy that created RT Systems. I talked to them back at Dayton, and I keep intending to put together a program with some depth on programming radios. Not just how to, but because that's not hard. With the software and the various tools that for computer loading software into radios, and the more important part these days is searching out the data, getting the repeaters and frequencies that you want into the radio, and that's. That's not hard, although I do have a phrase that I use. Computer loading software into a radio's computer programming radios is fast-er. It is not fast. I can spend hours getting a radio program for a trip. And I did not have those hours before this trip at any point along the line. And so these radios are not programmed for this trip. Flexible enough, the scanner is scanning all the 6 meter, 2 meter, 220, 440 frequencies. So if something pops up in terms of activity, I will hear it. But as we all know, with most repeaters, there's not a lot of activity, so they're not going to be on the air all the time. And that means I won't know that they're there as I pass them. And R-Finder has the ability to plan a route. That's one of the things I talked to Bob about. It's pretty cool. But it's not just, well, okay, put in your start, put in your finish, and throw everything into the radio. Because it gives you a fairly chaotic view of the frequencies that are in its database. They are pretty much listed in the direction that you're going, but there's a lot of trash in the database and some redundancy. And so it's not something where you just want to wholesale toss stuff in. You have to be kind of selective. And the other thing that takes some time is filling out the field in the database that will show up as the display on your radio and give you something that makes sense. So I've got that program to do, and many other programs to do. Kind of wish I'd had that done by now. I need to hire an editing staff. I was reading an article on Leo Laporte, W6TWT, who you're not going to hear on the radio, on the ham radio, anytime soon, I'm pretty convinced. It was talking about how he got Twit started, and in the early days it was all audio, and he did all the audio editing, and as fast as he could, he hired a staff of people so that all he had to do was sit there in front of the mic, and then not too much later the video camera, and talk. And he says he loves that. That's so much easier. He hates writing, editing. He doesn't like editing video or audio. And so he's hired people to do all that for him. I would love to be in that position where I just talk and pontificate and hand the stuff off to somebody else. He also does programs that mostly don't require a lot of editing. He's, you know, figured out a few things for getting a lot of content out without a lot of processing time. Bert, K1OIK, if you're listening at this point, I'm sorry. Bert will send me not an email. He mostly makes his comments on YouTube. Once in a while he sends an email, but mostly his comments come on YouTube. There's another program that you could have made 10 minutes, and instead it's 90 minutes. The last one he added that comment to was the parody in the Senate. When I was talking to Mike Lysenko and Chris Imlay on Skype, and we talked for, I think, a little over an hour. He said it could have been 10 minutes. Bert, these programs are not made for you. They're made for the people who like to get that depth and all of the stuff that comes around the core information. And you are absolutely 100% welcome to lift the stuff off of YouTube, edit them down into something, a little tight little package, and put them on your own darn YouTube channel. I appreciate it if you give me credit as the original source, and you can take credit as the person who edited it into a concise little package, and then we'll both share the glory. You see, I can't afford an editing staff, but if you want to stop complaining and start editing, there you go. I'd call that a win-win. But if you'd rather just sit there and complain and make snide comments on YouTube, well, feel free. So the DCC, have I got any thoughts about that? Well, the whole weekend is, you know, right now just kind of swimming back in my head. I noticed that the Flex talk, the one that I put online immediately at their, more than their request, and they paid me to put it on quickly. I've collected contributions from a lot of you, and that you're all looking forward to the programs from the DCC as fast as I can get them on. And so, you know, I'm a little bit conflicted about the idea of one particular presenter, even if it's a company, or maybe it's especially if it's a company, paying me, and it was a significant amount of money, to put theirs on first. I'm not 100% comfortable with that. I'd be comfortable with that. I'd be fine with that. I'm not 100% comfortable with the idea that you are 100% comfortable with it. Because you may have made a $100 contribution and you may be saying, well, what am I, chop liver? Can I specify a program that I'd like to see on real fast? And, you know, that would be pretty chaotic. Although I suppose I could start a bidding war. It would work in my favor. Oh, this is cool. There's a bunch of towers out there. I don't know if you probably can't see them. They're off to the right. It's, you know, it looks like it'd be an AM array of some kind, directional AM array. Three towers. I mean, it might just be three towers, but they all look about the same height and in a line. Pretty typical of a directional AM array. So, I don't. If I had like a bidding war for putting programs on first, that, oh, we're gonna go right at it. They're in right at it. The three tower array, and now it's a four tower array. I think. See what that turns out to be, because it looks like I'm going right towards it, and kind of out in the middle of nowhere. So, might not be brought. Well, too tall for transmission lines, I think. We'll see. Is there an airport nearby? I don't see one on the map. I've got the map kind of zoomed in. Yeah, don't see one on the map. So, if you want to comment on the concept, I'll listen. And as usual, I'll do what I want to do once I've listened. But it does appear to be popular, and evidently someone has been spreading the word beyond me, because in a little over 24 hours, it's climbed up to about 1,000 views, and that's not highly precedented. There have been a few other programs that climbed that fast, but mostly not. Yaesu Fusion. There was a talk on Yaesu System Fusion. It was in the introductory sessions, so I didn't get a chance to listen to it. But I talked to the fellow who gave the talk afterwards in the demo room. I didn't record it. Kind of wish I had. His name is Chris, and he's from the Minneapolis area. It's not the Chris who is the sales guy or the technical guy from Yaesu. This Chris, who I would give you his last name and his call sign, but I don't remember them, and you can't look them up as I'm driving here, and I didn't properly prepare. He's not a Yaesu employee. He's just sort of an enthusiast. He's a kind of evangelist for Fusion. He'd done D-Star and stuff, and Fusion is what he thinks is the future. But the news is starting with the idea that their digital system and the repeater was not capable of operating on their internet linked system. The software and hardware and whatever they need to do to make that work was not ready. And some of the reason behind that, and I'm just kind of deducing this, four lit up towers up ahead of me, and I'm still heading right at them, and they're pretty tall. Some of the reason for that, I am deducing from some of the things that he told me, were that in Japan, there's not a lot of repeaters, a lot more simplex going on. So the Wires X system, I'm in Orion, Illinois. The Wires X system was, on the digital side, set for simplex first, because that's what they use in Japan a lot. They have repeaters, but simplex appears to be much more popular. And it's worked here. If you had an FTM 400 mobile radio, you could set it up on WiresX in digital and drive around and talk to your base station out through the WiresX network, but they didn't have a way to hook it up to repeaters. So what they're going to do, and this will be available very end of November, basically beginning of December, if timeline holds, is set up a system where you can use their new dual band mobile radio, the FTM 100. I think you can use the 400 for this too, but they were showing it on the 100 as a remote link to the repeater. So you've got the FTM 100 at your house or wherever you want it with your internet connection and software on a computer running the WiresX interface. I'm right by those towers. They're spaced pretty far apart for an AM, but I don't see what else they would be. You know, it's kind of hard to tell here in the dark if they've got other stuff up on them or if they're pretty much just pure broadcast towers. I think I can see the red lights blinking in the yeah, you can see them. On the video. So you'll set up the base station or the FTM 100 mobile as a base station with the WiresX interface, a computer, and you put it on your Fusion repeater's frequency, and it becomes the link. It sends the signals that are scarfed up off of the internet, off of the whatever rooms or other links that you've got set up, off to the repeater. And it listens to the repeater and gets signals back and puts them out onto the internet. People have been doing that with Echolink and maybe even some IRLP. Basically, the link to the network is just another repeater user, essentially. I think I see a town ahead, or I see sun. No, I'm going straight south. It's not the sun. It's a town, I guess. There are some issues in doing that, not real serious issues, but first of all, of course, you want to make sure that if you're doing it, whether it's Echolink, IRLP, or Fusion, you want to make sure that your link station's got a good signal into the repeater. You also want to make sure it doesn't have a good signal into any other repeaters. And then typically that would happen, assuming that you've got it set up very local to your repeater in your town, and you're not up on a mountain 75 miles away. You want to control the signal so that typically during a band opening, this would become an issue, that link signal doesn't end up on the input to a co-channel repeater at whatever distance your co-channel repeater neighbors are. You know, if you're on 146.94, you've got one in your town, and maybe there's one 120 miles away. And most of the time, your base station signal's not going to get into it, but when there's a big band opening, it could. And if you're carrying a lot of network traffic, then that's not a good thing. That's the big consideration. So, you know, best practice for being a link into a repeater is to do it on a link frequency on another band, 220, 440, 900, 1200. It's nice out here on the back roads. I can even turn on my bright lights for a minute. So that's what they're going to do for the time being, is to set up the software so that the FTM 100 at your house or wherever you got your internet and computer is the link to the radio on the repeater's frequency. And I'm not very familiar with what the capabilities are in driving the network as a user from your radio as you're driving around town. But I believe you've got that capability. It looks like you can tell the repeater what... Yaesu calls them rooms. Others call them reflectors, or... I guess reflector is the more common generic term. Concentrations of multiple repeaters on a server someplace. Yaesu runs the servers. With D-Star, individuals run the servers. With Yaesu, I think Yaesu runs all the servers. I'm not positive about that, but I think that's the case. Wow, terrain elevation changes. Slight ones. But it's pretty flat out here. I'm already out of range of the 9-4 repeater back in Rock Island. Dial in the Peoria D-Star repeater. Let's see if I'm coming into range of that. KN4AQ mobile. No, nothing from the Peoria D-Star. I don't really know how far away from Peoria I am right now. So that is step one for them, and it may be the only step they take. In theory, they'll set it up so that you can put your WireZX link and a computer at the repeater site, which may or may not be a convenient place to put it. Okay, somebody wants to pass me. I will tell them, go ahead. They got cold feet about passing, and then finally, when I almost came to a stop, they decided to pass. And I can't wait for driverless cars. Well, on the one hand, I can't wait. They're going to probably become a thing just about the time when I'm too old to drive, which will be nice, because then I will just be able to have a car drive me around. But I'm pretty sure that it will be something like the end of serious mobile ham radio. I mean, you could probably take a handy talkie and clamp a, or you know, plunk a magnum mount antenna on the top if they'll let you. They might prohibit transmitting because the insurance companies in particular and the engineers will worry that a transmitter will interfere with the self-driving mechanism. So, you know, cell phones will have to be okay, like they are on airplanes now, or at least Wi-Fi, but HF, you know, that's not going to happen. I also think that the pundits are predicting that we won't own our own cars. Some people still will, I'm sure. Some people who will do a lot of traveling, but maybe especially in urban areas, you need to go to work. You punch a couple of buttons on your phone, and a couple minutes later, a car shows up in your driveway, drives you to work, and then heads off to drive other people some places. There'll be issues to work out with. You know, peak demand, and everyone's going to work at the same time, and you got to have all those self-driving cars, and they're not going to have very much to do during the rest of the day, but they'll have more to do than your car does just sitting in a parking lot somewhere. But there probably won't be a button listing specific accessories. Well, actually, there will be buttons listing specific accessories or configurations for the car that you order, and the more generic you make it, the sooner you're going to get a car show up. But I'm not expecting those options to include an HF amateur radio station with a Tar Heel antenna. I don't think that's going to happen. Who knows? Maybe it will. But the market's going to be a little too small for it. But it'd be fun. And if you get the station built into the car, well, then it's been all EMI tested and approved, and you know that it's not going to drive you off an embankment or into a bridge abutment just because you key up on 20 meters and start working DX. Look at all the traffic. I can't stand it. We're in Alpha, Illinois, a town of 700 people. So this is the beginning. This is the Alpha. I guess this is where they test things very early. Something is squeaking over there. I don't know what it is. Something is squeaking that doesn't normally squeak in this car. No. No? But I got a lot of stuff sitting over there on the seat. So, on the one hand, I'm kind of looking forward to self-driving cars. I mean, I enjoy driving, like a lot of people do. It would be kind of hard to give up the idea of taking the wheel, but I can also see it would be nice to let it go from time to time and have the car drive itself. And as everybody says, that transition period between where we are now and totally self-driving everything is going to be very awkward for the self-driving car people and for the rest of us trying to figure out how self-driving cars deal with human-driven cars. Google is still insisting that all the accidents its self-driving cars have been in were the fault of a human driver who hit the self-driving car. Well, we'll see. Is there anything I can talk about in terms of radio? 5 megahertz banging in. There's probably some people talking on 75 meters. I'll send the antenna over there.
$39.42. Okay. Well, Fred, it would be better for me if you don't care.
No, we'll do it. It goes on Friday. That's fine.
All right. It's not Friday.
There's some early birds.
All right. Well, whatever day you want to do it, it's fine. I need the help. I appreciate that. But don't forget, now, we got to take the time to get this sample down here in the house if you want it.
So you can't see the display here, but that these are a couple guys. The frequency I've got tuned is 3964.20 or 21. So either they don't care, or they've got legacy radios that don't have precision tuning.
Be quiet, very nice, but that point noise. Of course, the signals are up this morning, but the noise is up with it.
So Bob Heil went off on Ham Nation briefly about this idea of everybody lining up on an even kilohertz or some people on a 500 hertz segment. And of course, those of you that have followed Ham Radio Now religiously over the these many years. Perhaps remember my shows about channelizing, which didn't draw as much reaction as I was kind of hoping for. I was only pitching the idea of channelizing the 60-meter band, which we're hoping to get at the WRC conference, which is coming up next month in November. So we're hoping for a worldwide 60-meter band that the U.S. can participate in. And I was thinking, well, you know, as long as we started with channels, I like the idea of channels. I know that they are not ham radio. We suffered the concept, us early folks into FM in the 60s and 70s. There's nothing about FM inherently that needs to be channelized. But repeaters need to be because of the infrastructure that's in a repeater, particularly the duplexer, which is a very narrow-banded item on 2 meters. 70 centimeters, a duplexer can give you a couple of hundred kilohertz of wiggle room. But on 2 meters, with that, first of all, longer wavelength, and second, much shorter offset, 600 kilohertz on 2 meters versus 5 megahertz on 440, the stuff on 440 doesn't have to be as finely tuned on the cavities that make up the duplexer that keep the receiver out of the transmitter and vice versa. No, keep the transmitter out of the receiver. The receiver doesn't get in the... You know what I mean. On 2 meters, it's all much more critical, and you don't have, I don't know, 30 kilohertz of wiggle room, if that. So your repeater can't be frequency agile. So that, the repeater can be, but the duplexer will force it to one set of frequencies. So the advent of repeaters meant that the frequencies we used had to be channelized. And so in order to have a, especially in the early days, you wanted repeaters on the same frequency as often as you could reuse that frequency from one to another, because the radios that we had didn't have very many channels.
And there's the mic failure. Because I didn't have this thing plugged in quite tight enough. It sounds like a Geiger counter crackling like crazy. Okay, coming up next, the sun goes up, and it is time for another WWV check.
At the time, 12 hours, 55 minutes, Coordinated Universal Time.
And here you see the radio stack for a minute. Almost 12 hours GMT, 7:55 a.m. in the morning in Illinois, and we are listening to WWV on 5 megahertz. And I finally find some people on 60 meters. And yes, I know that the WRC just approved a little slice of 60 meters for a worldwide ham band. Not enough for a lot of phone channels. I don't know what's going to happen with it. We'll talk about it soon, but not now. But here's some guys on 60. Next, I checked into Midcars on 7255 after a quick look at WWV on 10 megahertz. And I use WWV as a quick propagation check, at least between wherever I am and Colorado, where they are. And it sounds pretty good. But you got to watch out for the trucks when you're mobile. And you'll see.
Yeah, okay. This is W0UZR for Midcars. I'll take one more shot at mobiles and then go back to fix. Any mobiles?
Hilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec.
Hilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Well, you're coming in here just as good as my friend Carl WRHA with his amplifier. And now I've Now, you got pretty good working mobile there.
Well, thank you. Just 100 watts. It's the ICOM 7000, and I'll credit most of it to the Tar Heel 200 full-size screwdriver antenna. It seems to perform very well. But, of course, you know, it's all the propagation band between you and me, and you're banging in here, too. I noticed that a semi was right next to the antenna, and that was the SWR all cattywampus, so this might be a little better again.
Now you're coming back up at, to a 9 again. Yeah, okay, any more mobiles before I go back to fix?
Very good morning to you, I'm from Switzerland. Kilo 7 Juliet Hotel, this is Henry Bravo 9, Romeo and Delta Echo 5 for now, good morning.
Okay, Rolf.
Okay, time to get off the interstate and work some DX. And this is HB9RDE in Switzerland, and I'm not sure what band we're on.
To the QSO, I'm looking forward to seeing you again. HB9RDE, K7JH, clear. Bye-bye, Rolf.
Thank you. Bye-bye, John. Good morning. I'm the 73 on QRZDX. I'm beaming North America, Canada, on the outside Europa, Henry Bravo 9, Radio Delta Echo.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Queen. This is Henry Bravo 9, Radio Delta Echo returning. Good morning to you. Thank you very much for the call. I'm your report is 59 here. My name is Rolf, Radio Ontario, Lima, Foxtrot, and my name Rolf, and the best of all is the 5-9 here, no problem. Kilo 94, Alpha 3, this is Henry Bravo 9, Radio Delta Echo.
Roger, Rolf, my name is Gary, Golf Alpha Romeo Yankee. I am Mobile in Illinois, middle of the country in Illinois. And you are 5x2, not real strong, but good signal. 5x2, 73 Rolf, KN4AQ, Mobile, Illinois.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much, Gary, from the mobile, from Illinois. This is no problem. Very good day. See you later. Good day. Bye for now, 73 from Switzerland. Good day. Bye.
Well, here's some more DX. But I don't know who I worked. He never gave his call sign. Not in any of the time I was recording, anyway. I think I might have broken a rule here, maybe.
Delta Kilo Florida, 5-9.
Okay, Italy, Kilo 1, Delta Kilo Fox, reported to 5-9,
Quebec. Roger, QSL, thank you. QRZ Europe?
Thank you very much, 73.
QRZ Europe? One more time, QRZ Europe? Negative, North America?
Whiskey Echo 2 November.
Whiskey Echo 2 November, 5-9.
59, thank you, 7-3.
Roger, thank you, QRZ North America.
Echo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
Sure. Okay, there was an X-ray Charlie, the X-ray Charlie.
I don't know who this is, but I'll look up and find out.
Roger, Whiskey Alpha 4, Hotel X-Ray Charlie, 5-9. Alrighty, thanks for the Crimson Tide State. Gentlemen, stand by one more time. I thought I heard a Middle Eastern station. Middle East only. The Middle East and Africa. Africa and the Middle East, QRZ. Africa and the Middle East. Africa and the Middle East. Negative. Thanks for standing by, guys. North America.
November 4, Alpha, Quebec.
Hotel Delta Victor.
With the Juliet uniform, you're going. Roger, K8EJU, 5-9. Thanks, Larry. Appreciate it. QRZ North America.
Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec.
Okay, the Lima Echo Echo, your call.
Whiskey 4 Lima Echo Echo.
Kilo Whiskey 4 Lima Echo Echo, 5-9.
Alright, 5-9 into Florida.
Roger. Thanks for Florida. QRZ?
Kilo November 4 Alpha Quebec.
Kilo Kilo Echo 4, Yankee Oscar Golf 59. Roger, thank you, QRZ North America.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Kilo.
Okay, the Romeo Papa, Romeo Papa. Kilo Charlie 8, Romeo Papa Victor 59. Roger, thanks for Ohio, QRZ North America.
November 4, Alpha Quebec, Romeo.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec, I believe, 59.
Roger, and I'm Mobile in Indiana, and you are 5x4.
Roger, roger, got a flash Mobile in Indiana, thank you. QRZ,
Kilo 5, Hotel Delta Victor.
KN48, approaching Indianapolis.
Okay, next we got a D-Star contact. This is with Don, WA9EIC. I'm getting close to Indianapolis, and I'm talking on their D-Star repeater. Don is on the local D-Star repeater in Danville, Illinois. It's about 50 or 60 miles behind me. I'd just gone right through there. You can't hear my end, but Don says some interesting things. He's a pretty interesting guy. So let's just string some of his comments together.
KM4AQ. WA9EIC. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you get to see real rural America instead of pounding pavement to get from here to there. I'm in Danville, Illinois. Danville is just across the state line into Illinois. A little bit north, but mostly west of Indianapolis. Name is Don, short for Donald. And I'm just sitting here on the couch contemplating getting hungry and having some lunch here in a little bit. Yeah, I'm on a local repeater here in Danville. It's a B module. But it's a composite station. And it's on Reflector 24 Bravo. And the W9ICE machine in Indianapolis evidently is. And that's how that works. I've been on a D-Star a few years. The repeater is mine. My son configured it for me. He's also a ham. And he lives up in Madison, Wisconsin. But anyway, enjoying monitoring the D-Star. I love the quality of this stuff. It's just fun. I carry HT coverage on this thing about 15 miles and mobile about 40. So don't get a whole lot of drive-by shootings, but a few. It's right on the I-74, so that's why I linked it into Reflector 24B. So people coming to or going to or coming from Indianapolis, why they can hear what's going on. It's kind of what's going on right now. Let's see, the little scroll thing says G-A-R-Y. I'm on an IC-80AD handheld on the super low. I'm running 50 milliwatts or something like that. And into the repeater, which I could literally throw a stone and almost hit. I look out the window here, I can see the tower the repeater's on. It's at 350 feet in Danville, Illinois Danville for you. Viewers. It's hometown of Dick and Jerry Van Dyke and Bobby Short, the entertainer, piano player, Gene Hackman, Donald O'Connor. Can't think of any others right now. Oh, yeah, and me. I'm recently retired 3 years ago, 40-year broadcasting career, engineer and some announcing. Talk show, sports broadcast, but just anchoring the sports. I didn't do play-by-play or anything like that. Spinning the dials, playing instant replays, you know, touchdown highlights and all that stuff, recording, producer, engineer, that type thing. Lots of fun, but primarily chief engineer, so lots of 2 a.m. after thunderstorm phone calls to go repair lightning damage. Missed the anchoring stuff, doing sports scoreboards and things like that, but I sure don't miss the 2 a.m. lightning storm calls, Gary. Over.
In 300 feet,
okay, Gary. Yeah, you really can't get it out of your system. You want the phone to ring, but you're tired. That hits me. I didn't do hardly any video. Well, I did back in the late 60s with analog tape. A little bit of freelance work that the people I worked for did. It was a local communications outfit. We did a little bit of video work, making some commercials. But that was all analog videotape editing, and it was tough. Rough, tough, and crude. Got away from that in a big hurry. But that was my first broadcasting work, was in very late 60s, early 70s. Got to engineer 50 kilowatt FM, and boy, that got into my blood in a big hurry. So I stuck with that after that. Did a little work at the airport, working on aircraft radios, and was a certified airman. Radio tech, work on all the nav equipment and the distance measuring and communications equipment for a small charter airline, and in the fixed base operation, working on their trainers and stuff like that. And anybody who happened to drove in needed battery change stuff, did all that kind of stuff, which usually involved in a small town like this, it usually involved repacking wheel bearings on the trainers and changing spark plugs and all that stuff. Fun stuff, but broadcasting was a whole lot cleaner and a lot less stressful. When a DJ sits down and spins records or what have you, telling my age now, plays music off the computer, that's a lot less stressful than watching an airplane take off that you just changed the magneto on, Gary. WA9EIC. Okay, Gary, honor to meet you. If you remember my call sign, I'm in QRZ. Email me the links and all that stuff, and I'd like to watch that video.
And then the camera battery died. I got some big batteries. Do I have one sitting here? I thought I put one over here, but I don't see it. I got big honking batteries for the cameras, but they don't last forever. So the battery finally died at some point, and again, I didn't see it because I wasn't watching it. And I was driving the car. So I guess I'll let Dan know when the video is up. I guess I'll let him know now because the video is up. Next, time for lunch. Just outside of Indianapolis, that's when I discovered that the mic connector had come loose. And I discovered it because it just fell out in my hand when I was moving the camera. And that's when I discovered that the battery died. So I fixed all that. And now you will hear me again on the video. So I don't need to come back and do anything here from the studio till the end and the goodbye. Well, we will see. But that wasn't the most interesting thing that happened at lunch. This was. K8VGL, KN4AQ, are you getting close?
Apparently it's on the south side, the underpass here. Are you, what's next to you there?
Just past an Arby's, there's a McDonald's on the other side and a BP, and yes, it is south of the overpass.
One more light, and I'll be there.
And if you're coming south, it will be on your right, an easy turn in without crossing the road. KN4AQ. So, you're not going to get away with us without getting on TV here.
I see that.
Who are you, and why were you stalking me?
Well, Jerry, K8VGL. And I'm stalking you because I wanted to have a chance to shake your hand and meet you. You've been driving by my house now twice and within a few miles, and my rare opportunity to meet the great Gary Pierce.
And I don't shake hands, I do the fist bump.
That's good.
So, Okay, so you were watching on APRS?
Yes, I was.
On APRS-FI or direct on radio?
APRS-FI.
Okay, so you've been seeing me come for a while.
I have been seeing you come for a long time, yes.
And you called me on 5-2.
Called me on 5-2.
I just got done with a D-Star conversation with a guy back in Danville.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm recording for the On the Road podcast. And I looked over the camera and the battery had died. So I'm not, somewhere in the middle of that conversation, the battery died on the camera. So you tracked me down and we are going to go eat some bad food there at White Castle.
Now your favorite, as I understand.
It's one of my favorites.
One of your favorites.
Actually, my wife would go nuts. There's a White Castle, there was a Steak and Shake up the road, and there's a McAllister's Deli right over there.
And I was actually going to take you to Scotty's Brew House, which is just right alongside of McAllister's.
Well, if you recommend that, we can go there.
Well, this is your only opportunity to get White Castle.
I had White Castle yesterday. So let's go where you like it. Are we walking distance here?
I don't know if we can walk across there. Yeah, it actually is walking distance.
Okay, we'll go get some exercise.
All right.
Let me lock up the car.
Okay.
Oh, I'll do it. I'll do this as a selfie for a minute. So what I'm learning is that this is the fellow who made the contribution for buying the camera that I'm looking at right now. And when I said it was $1,000, he sent me $100 for 10%. And then I said, well, it turns out the camera was a little more expensive. It was $1,400, so he sent another $50 to cover that and any tax. So you are super awesome.
Well, thank you. Well,
you can see yourself.
I can see myself. I understand. I didn't break the camera, and that's great.
Yep.
So I committed to 10% of the camera, so by golly, I had to pony up and get it. When I found out I didn't come through the first time.
And this is the camera that we're working with here, so we're good. And we're at Scotty's Brew House. So this is what it looks like. It's not White Castle, but it's going to be far better for me. And we are, by the way, at Indianapolis.
Yeah,
just outside.
Actually, just out of Indianapolis is this little bedroom community called Brownsburg, Indiana.
Okay. You lived here for a long time?
I actually don't live in Brownsburg. I live another 5 miles south of here. But yes, I've been here about 18, 20 years in this area.
What do you do?
I'm retired now, Gary.
You're only 35 years old.
I know. I had to use my fake ID to get inside of the bar here, but I still am retired. Yeah, I'm a retired EE engineer, that's how.
You were telling me outside on the way over that you don't understand all this stuff at the Tapper Conference, but you're an engineer. You understand it all.
Well, I don't understand a lot of the software things that they're going into because I'm not really expert and understand a lot of the C language and the things they're talking about. Yeah, but I do understand.
But you got a better idea than I do of what they're talking about. Okay, so we're going to do lunch.
All right.
We're going around the Beltline around Indianapolis. And we'll look for something to yammer about here. I got a little battery. I got a little hard drive left. So let me see what I can figure out. You are watching or listening to Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. If you enjoy this episode, no, Flex did not pay for this one. Flex paid for the last one. If you enjoy this episode, stop by hamradionow.tv and find Arvin. Click on his little icon and help us out. Appreciate it. Gas is expensive. Well, actually, gas is fairly cheap, but compared to what it was, but it's still, doing these things is not cheap. All right, be back in a minute with something to talk about. This is making noise here. Which one of you radios is making a lot of noise? I can't tell. Too many radios. Oh, it's the 5-2. I'm learning this from Christian and Katie on 100 Watts and a Wire. This is Ham Radio Now. Stand by.
At the tone, 18 hours, 33 minutes, Coordinated Universal Time.
So that works out to 2:33 in the afternoon here in the Eastern Time Zone now that I'm in Indiana. Started in the Central Time Zone.
And I think I've got the camera pointed where you can see things. 15-meter signal for WWV is banging in. Did I say 15-meter? 15 megahertz. 10 megahertz is doing good. And the antenna is set for 20-meter band. Probably won't hear 5 megahertz. And the 20 megahertz signal is not making it. Wasn't making it before, although the 17 meter band was fairly open. We rock the antenna down to, oh no, the antenna is at 17 meters. Let's see if there's anybody to hear. I think I did my DX pilot busting here on 17. Okay, so one of the diatribes that I was going on that didn't make it on the mic that had fallen out was signal reports.
QTH near Halifax. QTH near Halifax, Tom. 7X
so did you...
5 Kilo Bravo Sierra. You have CHW over.
Yeah, I'm not hearing the DX station he's talking to. So you gave, heard that 5-5 signal report that guy gave? That's unusual. Very unusual. I monologued and diatribed a bit on signal reports. One of the DX stations that I think I played a bit of was giving 5-9 signal reports to everybody. And I was questioning whether they were real signal reports or just feel-good signal reports. I was talking about how I think that this everything's 5-9 came from contests. Back in the old days, in the very distant, deep, dingy past, contests required signal reports as part of the exchange. They still do, but people gave real signal reports. And I think eventually they realized that they were churning their brain power on figuring out what a signal report was, or understanding what the signal report they were receiving was. And that slowed down their ability to conduct the contest. And eventually contest signal reports all became 5-9. Everybody's 5-9. Some contest organizers realized that all those bogus reports were just wasting time. Many did not. You know, many contests still keep the signal report as part of the exchange, and you know, it's just everybody says 5-9. Why bother? Get rid of the signal reports. But then that sort of leached its way into a lot of ordinary contacts, probably more DX contacts than just casual Rag 2 contacts. But you hear a lot of 5-9s. So I wish people would give realistic signal reports. And if you're new and all you hear is this 5-9 stuff, then maybe it's not too late for you. It's too late for everybody else. So the 5 is in the signal report. In phone, it's RS, readability and strength. And in Morse code, it's RST. Readability, strength, and tone. The readability, you almost never hear anybody give less than a 5. But the sad part is they'll say things like, yeah, you're 5 and whatever. Maybe they'll be a little bit more honest about the strength and say, you're 5'7". But I missed your name, and where were you located again? Which means a five readability is supposed to be, I can copy you solid. It's like you're standing next to me and it's nice and quiet. Everything is good. So if they missed your name and they missed your location, well, It's not a readability 5. It's something considerably less than that because they're missing pieces. A 4 is I can hear everything, but it's a little tough. I got to pick things out. 3 is I'm missing pieces. A 2 is I get something now and then. And a 1 is I can tell you're there, but I really am not getting any usable information out of you. So when was the last time you heard a signal report that had anything less than a 5? Odds are you didn't, unless you were in the county hunter's net. And although they modify the technique a little bit, those guys are dedicated to giving realistic signal reports. But it's in their own kind of a shorthand. Tell you what, let me, do I want to point the camera back up there? Yeah, if I'm going to monologue, I'll give you a view of the road, although it's just kind of heavy traffic. Sorry about it being cockeyed. The tripod is sitting cattywampus, and unless I'm pointed straight out the front, it's at an odd angle. So we're going around the Beltline around Indianapolis. So that's the readability side, and the strength side, probably most people correlate that to an S meter reading. So if it's S8, they'll say you're 5'8". If it's S2, they'll say, all right. If it's S2, they'll still say you're 5'8", because they don't want to make you feel bad. I can't tell him he's S2. He'll feel bad. I can't tell him I'm missing pieces. I'll give him a 5, not a 3. You're really a 3.2. I'll give you a 5.7 because, you know, it's grade inflation. I bet somebody who gives a 5.8 when they really mean 3.2 would complain about their local school doing grade inflation. Or they'd complain about the local kids' softball team giving everybody a trophy, even if all I did was show up. But they'll still give somebody a 5.2 because they don't want to hurt you for a 5.8. Instead of a 3.2, because they don't want to hurt your feelings. The strength part doesn't necessarily have to come from an S meter reading. Let's see what this guy sounds like.
I got your name here. My name is Rob Romeo, Oscar Bravo.
Okay, right now, with that noise that's getting generated by something near me, right now his readability went into the toilet. It was a readability 2, maybe. But his strength was strong. He was S9 or S8. So he was a 2.8. If I didn't have an S meter, couldn't see an S meter, if I were just picking it out of how strong he seemed, that becomes much more subjective, and it's still legitimate to do that. This RST system was developed before S meters were ubiquitous. So you give their perception of how strong someone can be, and they may sound strong. If he comes back, we'll see how strong he sounds. But you look at the S meter and he's not that strong at all. So an S meter is probably a bit more objective way of giving a strength report. But the readability.
Still 5 and 6, so excellent copy. Audio is good as well.
Okay, so I can hear plenty of hiss behind him. He's not super strong, not running the AGC to total colliding the background noise. So I'm going to guess, like he said, 5.6. I'm going to guess he's about an S6. Let's take a look.
To the next time, dear friend. Thank you for the call. Have a good evening.
Okay, actually quite a bit lower than that.
From Rome. Zero, Victor X-ray, Lima, VLOP, CSW,
serial friend. Gives his call so fast I couldn't get it. It was a VO something, Canada. He was S3. So he wasn't a 5.6 at all. He was a 5.3. And I could work plenty of signals that are doing almost nothing on the S meter, but if the background noise is low, they could be 5.0. That's quite possible. And if the noise is high, like it was back there a little bit, then they could be a 3 or a 2-9 or a 2-8. If it's continuous noise and or QRN, QRM, adjacent frequency signals that are kind of bleeding in, the strength can be strong and the readability poor. So, you know, I don't expect that I'm going to do a one-man campaign to encourage more realistic signal reports. But if you're a new ham, just be aware of what you're getting out there. And the feeling that you get when you're giving a signal report and not wanting to hurt someone's feelings, and decide how you want to handle it. Let's see what else we got here on 17. We're tuned in on 18140. One of the other things I was monologuing about was this concept of tuning into the even kilohertz, or sometimes 500 hertz, which I think is a great idea. But Bob Heil on a recent Ham Nation was criticizing that. It was an off-the-cuff remark. He wasn't getting real deep about it. Not as deep as I'm about to get. He was just saying, why does everybody try to get on this even kilohertz? It's sort of like, because we can, our equipment lets us. Back in the day, and even today, if you talk to somebody who's not on an even kilohertz, or some on a 500 hertz, 0.5 kilohertz, they're probably running legacy equipment, the old VFO, that doesn't have the precision calibration. So they can't spot themselves on an even kilohertz unless they tune in somebody who already is. And just end up on that frequency. There's a little bit of advantage to it in that it will enforce some separation of signals. You're going to at least be 500 hertz. Well, 500 hertz is, they're right on top of each other. You're at least going to be a kilohertz away. That's still too close. 2 kilohertz is a little too close. 3 kilohertz is great. There's plenty of elbow room for even a pretty strong adjacent signal. I'm talking sideband here, of course. Let's see who else is out here, if anybody is. Not really strong enough to spend time on from a mobile. Nope. Most of the band is quiet. Let's go back to 20. Send the antenna over there. Send the radio. WWV still pounding in.
$14,258. Yeah, not too many people in today.
Okay, that guy's readability 5.
Dave in Ohio came in.
I'm going to say strength 7, 8.
Sometimes we get a few others. Roger up in New Jersey.
And
Larry
S-meter wise, yeah.
In Iowa. So,
that's what I'm seeing, 7. 6, 7.
Yeah, turn the beam back to north. I can hear you better.
Peak's hitting 9 now and then.
Much metal in the way if I
pointed
towards the east.
Ah. That's probably a free DV signal. It's on 14230, yeah, 236. And it went away. 14236 is the informal free DV digital voice on 20 meters frequency. Tune a little lower and I'll probably come across some slow scan TV. Yep, analog slow scan TV. I don't care how dead 20 meters is, there's a slow scan TV signal going. And if the frequency seems quiet, just make a peep on voice and suddenly a slow scan signal will pick up.
Get out of state that much anymore. However, I just retired last week, so that all could change.
14-220 on the nose. Not hearing the guy he was talking to. I also monologued about skip zones. How on 20 meters they are moderate to short, and then 17 meters get a little longer, 15 meters a little longer, 12 and 10 meters even longer. And the skip zone being, because derived from the word skip, and where did skip come from? Is it like stones skipping off the surface of a pond, you know, flat stone when you fling it off into a pond and it skips? I say no. I don't think that's the actual derivation. This is just from research. Whoever invented it didn't tell me in person, and I didn't invent the term, but I think that it is more derived from the idea that the signal heads up to the ionosphere, bounces off and comes back down, but is not heard directly below where it does the bouncing. A patch of earth is skipped by your signal. It skips that area, and that, I think, is why it is called skip. So if you hear a conversation that's one-sided on any of these HF bands, then you're hearing the signal from one station. The signal from the other station is skipping over you. Tune in 14-275 for a minute. That's the frequency that K1MAN used to occupy. And when I was
Tango, Mexico.
When I was heading back from the beach vacation, when the hurricane was approaching, K1MAN was back on the air with a short repetitive transmission saying that the International Amateur Radio Society, IARN, Amateur Radio something, IARN, I think, network, is on the air or doing something because of the current hurricane. So it was generic, you know, any hurricane, not hurricane specific. And then send traffic to, and they gave a web address. I don't understand what it was all about. I thought that license was finally allowed to completely lapse. So, I don't know. I didn't go to the website. He said, for more information, go to K1MAN, I think it was .com, which I didn't do at the time. Haven't done to see what they were saying that they were. But it was a bizarre announcement. It was like not handling anything on that frequency, just send traffic to a website or to an email address and go to the website for more information. And I'm thinking, I don't understand. Anyway, I don't hear them now, 14-275. Because there's no current hurricane. I was speculating that maybe, you know, the guy just wanted to tweak the FCC and put a signal back on and was going to claim it was under emergency conditions so that he could do it. But he didn't say that, and again, I haven't gone to the website. So that's just sort of a guess, and that pickup truck's facing the wrong way. Okay, so I'm going to do what I like to do out here in the middle of no place, and that is get off the highway and take what I'll call a back road, or in this case, U.S. Highway, U.S. 40. We're going to go through a little bit of city for a while, but then we'll be out in the country and off of the interstate with all the trucks. And trucks are valuable, like truckers. Trucks aren't a problem. It's just if I can get out of being in the middle of them, I kind of want to. So let's get off on US 40 and see some countryside. Tuning up 20, the rest of the band.
About a 5-3 into Florida.
Well, another pretty realistic signal report, 5-3. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about with all this signal report enhancement I've been whining about. And I can't hear the other station, so I'm in the skip zone. I guess they haven't re-recorded that since they could do email or go to a website. Who's going to mail a letter? All time, all the time, WWV. In a moment, more time, but now we make time for the time. And also propagation reports and an occasional weather forecast for people out in the middle of the ocean. All right, so WWV is banging in at 15 megahertz. Propagation to Fort Collins, Colorado is good. Doesn't mean it's good anyplace else, but it's good out to there. So I use that as a bit of a indicator of what spectrum is open, at least to Fort Collins, you know, sort of across the U.S. I wonder if you guys in other parts of the world, and a lot of you say that you enjoy watching these over-the-road programs because you like seeing what the U.S. looks like in different parts of the country. Here, you're looking at the edge of urban Indianapolis, Indiana. But I wonder what you guys get out of WWV or other standards stations. I'm sure you can hear WWV around the world. At times, he said, making a very weak joke out of it. But do you get anything else out of it? Well, I'm going to go back to listening to a recorded podcast. And when I get out into the countryside, I'll show you what some countryside looks like. And I'm burning daylight on these slow roads, but I'm having a much better time than if I were on the interstate. So you will hear me in just moments, assuming the microphone cord didn't fall out again. And I will have a interlude. And this is Ham Radio Now. This is the 20 megahertz version of WWV, so the propagation is continuing to move up in frequency, and it's pretty strong. It's about S9. You're looking out at the more rural territory, although this road has continued to have some development along it, not just farm fields. So it's a four-lane, pretty big highway.
38 minutes, coordinated universal time.
3:38 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Okay, this is more fieldish. Widen out here a little bit. Hope you're getting a fairly wide perspective. It doesn't really look in the quick glance I can get at the viewfinder. It doesn't look like it's super wide, and if I pan over, the tripod is kind of leaning at an angle, and the camera just points down. Doesn't work. I'll show you, prove it. But now there's no field. Now it's another house. You see how it's getting cattywampus. Going through a little town. very little town. It's only just a little slow down of the speed limit. It's about all that was to this town. So, 20 megahertz. It could be 15 meters will be open. Let's find out. Starting at 14.2 and working up.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
Ending Quebec, please. Ending Quebec.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec.
Listening to prefix on QO Mexico. Kilo something Alpha Quebec.
Kilo November, Kilo November, Kilo November.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Queen, roger.
Roger, roger. Name is Gary, North in Mobile in Ohio. Mobile in Ohio, and you are 5x5. 5x5. Go ahead.
QSL, Gary, Kilo November 4, Alpha Queen. Name is Peter. Thanks for the 55. You're both the same. 5x5, Gary, over.
Roger, 73, KN4AQ.
Thanks, Gary, 73. Zulu Delta 7, Foxtrot Tango.
So, that was one of those by ear signal reports because I didn't have time to look at the meter. What do you think he is? Clearly a 5.
QSL 10, London, Ontario, thanks for 5 and 9. Yeah, you're beautiful 5 and 9 in the same domain this evening. Information if you need a card on QRFit.com. That'll be an afternoon, 7-3.
He is mostly S0 and occasionally S1.
Mike Zero.
Very low noise level, 15 meters, you know, typical low noise level. Just by ear, I call him a 5-5, and he's a S-meter-wise, 5-1 or 5-2. So where is St. Angelina? Is that what he was saying? I have no idea. It sounds like it's a long ways away. Let's see if there's anybody else on the band. Oh, and in post-production, I'm probably pulling this guy up on QRZ.com and showing you where he is. So we all know from watching the video, I guess you audio listeners, you're just going to be kind of stuck. Maybe I'll turn on a mic and feed it in. The station is in the Azores. No, I was making that up. But maybe I did something like that. Or maybe I will. I'm speaking to myself in the future.
The station is on St. Helena Island in the South Atlantic.
There's a small town. It's one of the things that I did before that I think missed the video or missed the audio. It's small town America on these U.S. highways. And this highway has gotten smaller. 4-lane down to a 2-lane. And we're going to go right smack through the downtown. And this is classic small town America. Couple of blocks of shops, and we'll get a longer look at them because we get a red light. Let's tune the rest of 15, see if he's the only signal. For a small town, this has got a lot of traffic lights. I must have gotten a grant. Typically a town that size, one traffic light in the middle would have been plenty. And the speed limit will inch its way back up from 30 to 45.
And we're back to a four-lane road. It just shrank down to two lanes for the little town. I guess they weren't going to push all those storefronts out of the way to widen the road. And we're back up to 60. Looks like our next little town is a good ways down the road, so we might have some open highway here for a while. I know you're impressed with my Mobile DX prowess now. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. So I'm not getting everything he's saying. I would give that report a 4 or a 3 by 0. 3 by 0. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. So it's Victor Papa 2, Echo, Tango, Echo. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec.
Kilo November 4, Papa Quebec, Roger.
America, Quebec, Alpha, Quebec.
Okay, Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Victor Papa 2, Echo, Tango, Echo, you're 5-7.
Roger, you are 5-0. I can copy you, but nothing on the S-meter. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much, my friend. 5-0. I'm running 101 into the Alpha Delta LD plus antenna up 60 feet. Over.
All right. Well, it's got a signal here. Not real strong. I'm a 100-watt mobile. 100-watt mobile in Ohio. Go ahead.
Okay, well, you went up to 5-9 on the last transmission. Be over.
Yep, and you are S3 now. You're up to S3, so getting stronger. 73, KN4AQ Mobile. My name is Gary.
Okay, my friend. Name here is 76. You're the best safe driving. And
73.
You are there. Big Department of Labor, Echo.
Not coming up in the QRZ droid. I'll have to listen more carefully on playback and see if I can tell who that is.
Victor Papa 2, Echo Tango Echo, is on Anguilla in the Caribbean.
I'm not even sure. I'm such a bad ham in terms of DX. I cannot spout off where all of these prefixes are from. I should be able to do better than that, especially like a VP7. I mean, it could be Caribbean. Could be Africa. Sure sounds like Victor Papa 7 Echo Tango Echo to me. And you are watching or listening to Ham Radio Now.
Our cup. Our mug.
We're attempting it. Wait a minute.
I'm not sure. She may be just having me hold my cup out like an idiot for the neck.
Hold on there, Christian. Katie. I'm listening to 100 watts in a wire. And I am crossing into Ohio. I thought they had a banner or something over the highway. Did I tell that DX station I was in Ohio? Maybe I wished I... Oh, there's the arch. I wished I was in Ohio. Not because I don't like Indiana, but because I would have been farther along. I was thinking that I would be way east of Dayton by about 4 o'clock, and it's now 4:30, and I am just crossing into Ohio. That's what happens when you dawdle, dilly-dally, shilly-shally, meander your way across the country as opposed to getting on the interstate and boom, 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 go, go, go. So, oh yeah, where was I? Katie and Christian, their last episode. Not their last.
Stuck. Right?
Not their last episode. Well, their most recent episode. Although something in the notes said it was going to be on hiatus. I haven't heard what they're talking about yet. Probably won't be till the end. So go back to listening to that. KN4AQ, Mobile 8 in Ohio.
I keep on holding it as it is.
Damn it, my hands figured out shaking. What I was up to. Hold on, I gotta get my snag it.
Are you trying to trick your computer to take a picture?
Okay, put Christian and Katie back on hold. Reason I'm rolling the video is this is one of the directions the talk-in stations for Dayton Hamvention give for people coming from the west to go down US 49. Is it US or Ohio? I was just in Chicago. That's the one of the D-Star repeaters here in Dayton, but I'll resist coming back to him for a minute. Okay, so it's Ohio 49. And I am going to go take a look at the Hera Arena. I'm curious to see if there's any construction going on there. There was a brief note that I saw the headline of on the ARL website about the Hamvention committed to being back at the Hera Arena. And the last year there was a sign, didn't have a lot of information, but it indicated that the arena was going to get a makeover. So I wonder if we'll see any signs of being made over. It may have even had a date, and I may be able to dredge it up when I put this little piece of video together and see what that sign is, but I don't remember much in the way of details or promises, other than it had nice pictures of things all spiffed up. So this is the route that you take if you were coming in from the Indiana area and going straight to the Hera Arena. I've never done this route because I've never done that route. What? What did I just say? My driving is more in gear than my brain is. Yeah, I did get up at like 3 this morning. And it's coming up on 5 o'clock. Been a long day. I'm going to stay. When I stop here, I'll book a motel just on the other side of Dayton. Fight the traffic now or in the morning. It's 5 p.m. According to a local repeater. It is actually weird being in Dayton when the Hamvention is not in operation. I've been here a time or two outside of Hamvention time, but it is weird. Okay, so there it is. I'll turn in. Got that gate closed. Maybe all closed. If that's the case, I'll come back around. But there's nothing happening there. There's no event. Like I can get in. I'm seeing no signs of any improvement going on. Some signs at the door of the ball arena. Hera Arena sign is totally empty and missing. Well, don't see any indication that anything is being reconstructed yet. The last time I came through here, I think it was the same deal. It was maybe coming back from a Tapper conference in Chicago in 08 or 09. Let me spin around again. I'm too lazy to turn the camera. Well, I can't turn the camera because the tripod is cattywampus. There you go. riding out. There we go. Lights are on, but nobody's home. And so the last time I came through out here in the parking lot, this is where the flea market begins. There was an outdoor concert being set up. It wasn't in operation, but it was being set up. It's so weird. This is the world's largest ham fest, by far. There's nothing here. Let me spin around again so you can see. Let me see. Turn around. Let me see. There we go. Mendelssohn sits about there. There's a mound of snow. I could go skiing. They dumped some ice, it looks like. Our local repeaters are coming alive a little bit. So weird. Still flea market, this territory. I'll give you one more spin in. Yep, so I have to go all the way around here. Nothing, nada. Okay, there's a sign on the door. I got to go look and see what that sign says. Something about no smoking. Can you read it? This is the ultimate in lazy. Okay, so whatever that said. And now, let's see if I can find a hotel and go edit this. So weird.
I had this sort of a nightmare.
Okay, so I'm back listening to Christian and Katie. 100 watts and a wire.
Facebook group. You asked for analysis.
And I think about to come into view is beautiful downtown Dayton, obscured by some beautiful green signs.
It was, somebody even asked her, like, what were you drinking?
I'll let the video keep running.
Not have any alcohol, but for some reason, I just had this weird dream of all of these.
What could be more appropriate? 100 watts on a wire and beautiful downtown Dayton.
And I was dreaming, I couldn't get the computer.
I think I'll get a good shot right up here. It's got potential if that viaduct doesn't get in the way.
Even turn on the radio. So I'm sitting in front of this big, beautiful icon of 7851 and going, I can't even turn it on.
Christian, Katie, what other podcast does their podcast playing your podcast?
The only way I could get the computer to start was I had to enter my password. But I had to do it as I was hanging off this ledge with mulch.
Send ham radio now some love.
Pieces of mulch that would work so that I could spell out the letter. I mean,
so tell you what, I'm going to wrap this up here. That's the last thing I wanted was a little shot of Dayton, and that's what I got, a little shot of Dayton. And it's time to end this this episode of On the Road in the Dark, or at least it was going to be in the dark. I'm Gary. Wait. Hey, Jerry. They say... By the way, thank you for lunch. Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
They say, and I don't know if I qualify in this category, don't meet your heroes. You're going to be disappointed. But we had a great lunch.
Yes, we did.
And I want to give you the opportunity, if you know, if you're as good a fan of the program as you make yourself out to be, how we close the show, I'm going to let you do the close for this show.
You're going to let me do this close, all right?
Yes. It's all yours.
Okay.
Take it away.
Well, first off, I have to identify myself. I'm Jerry, KVGL, and you are?
Oh, I'm Gary, KN4AQ.
Over and out.
He knows how to close the show.
Sure I do. Hold on, I just can't turn the switch off and make it fade. You'll have to do that.